subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Disha Ravi, a young environmental activist from Bengaluru, has been arrested. There are warrants, non-bailable warrants against a Mumbai lawyer, 30-year-old Nikita Jacob, and also a Pune engineer, that is Shantanu. So these three are wanted in what Delhi police now says is a larger conspiracy to join hands with separatist or disruptive or secessionist forces across the world and to try and create trouble in India, especially on January 26, but generally to do with the farm agitation. What this has also done is, this has brought several new acronyms into our lives. So first of all, there is FFF, triple F, that is Fridays for Future. It is the most familiar so far, because this is where Greta Thunberg has been active, because this started with talking about environmental issues at your school on Fridays. So that is one that is sort of better known. Then there is Poetic Justice Foundation. Remember, it's not a foundation for poetry. It's Poetic Justice Foundation. Poetic justice, as you know, is a metaphor. Oh, this was poetic justice. What is poetic justice? If I may put it purely in cricketing terms, that is, if Englishmen said that Chennai pitch, Chepauk pitch was so bad and so spinner friendly that nobody could bat on it, it was a graveyard, that India's top spinner comes and scores 100. That is poetic justice served on the English. So poetic justice is a metaphor. Poetic Justice Foundation, although what the foundation is doing has nothing to do with anything cricketing, etc., etc., nothing as nice as that. Then there is also SFJ, Six for Justice, a banned organization in India, banned almost 2 years ago, 2019. And then there are some others that are not so familiar. For example, there is Extinction Rebellion, and we will come to that. So what do all these add up to? When you see these arrests and you see these dark stories and you see the talk of Khalistan movement being revived again, frankly, if you ask me the truth, I avoid saying Khalistan movement. I might call it a separatist movement, a radical movement, but I will not go so far as to give respect to it as a proper noun, to the concept as a proper noun, because the idea never found roots in Punjab with the Sikhs, even at the height of insurgency and terrorism between 1981 to 1993, the worst periods for 1990 to 1992. Even then, this concept never found any roots. So I think by talking about this again and again and again and again, what we do is paint the devil on the wall, and I prefer not to do it. So I will not use this word again in the rest of this Cut the Clutter. So what is the charge against these people, particularly these two women, one who's been arrested, the other who carries a non-bailable warrant in her name and has gone to Bombay High Court now to seek anticipatory bail, and also the third one, the engineer, he also has a non-bailable warrant. The charge is that they devised a toolkit which they sent to Greta Thunberg to share with all activists. So first of all, what's a toolkit? So it sounds like something very conspiratorial. And that's how, if I see responses on social media, also lots of responses that I've got from you on the last couple of days, Cut the Clutters, they say, talk about the toolkit. Toolkit as if it's some big mysterious thing. A toolkit is a simple thing. It's like when you are starting something, standard operating procedures. And the toolkit says you want more resources, resources not for money, but resources of knowledge, information for spreading your message, create tweet storms, use these hashtags. There is nothing in the toolkit, because I've read it very carefully, there is nothing in the toolkit itself that sounds subversive or that sounds instigatory of violence, because even the law of sedition is applied when your criticism or attack on the government instigates violence. Delhi police says, on the other hand, that because this toolkit talks about action in front of Government of India offices, also offices globally of Ambani and Adani, Indian interests, and also Indian embassies and missions, there is message of subversion. Then they also go on to say that many of the links mentioned in this toolkit, to which activists can go for more advice or more suggestions are subversive. For example, they point out to something called AskIndiaWhy.com, which they say is a Sikh separatist operation or an operation run by anybody or groups that support Sikh separatism in India. Now, no surprise, I tried checking out that website. So I did try to reach AskIndiaWhy.com and I did try to Google it, but then I got a notification saying that server can't be accessed, obviously because government of India has banned it in India, so you can't access it in India. But when you read about it, you know that this is talking about, say, issues of discrimination in India and issues bordering on the subversive. In fact, if you go to the website of Poetic Justice Foundation, that website also says to know more about us, go to AskIndiaWhy.com, and then because you can't go to AskIndiaWhy.com, your path is closed there. So there is something really funny about Poetic Justice Foundation and something worse than funny about AskIndiaWhy.com, but those are the two things which are separate, and I will tell you how they are connected with the larger story. Whether just they are being connected with the story also makes everybody who might have opened this toolkit or might have changed this toolkit or might have even authored this toolkit, does it make them all accessory to the crime of plotting against the nation, against India, and subversion and Sikh separatism and radicalism? That is a question to which we have to look for an answer, and I will conclude this with a little bit of an opinion. So I am warning you. Now, these toolkits are standard operating procedure, as I told you. Now, in fact, for decades, for any agitation, mass agitation, toolkits like these are made. Now, because there is social media available, because there is internet available, these are very easily circulated. In the past, they may have been circulated through pamphlets, through messages, through placards. So, for example, the Occupy Wall Street movement had its own toolkits going around on social media and on internet. Similarly, the Hong Kong movement, the anti-CAA movement in India about a year ago, they all had toolkits. So a toolkit by itself is not a criminal plan of action. A toolkit is a legitimate instrument or legitimate plan for a peaceful protest as well, unless the toolkit says use violent methods. Then it walks into the area of crime. It crosses the thin line between peaceful protests and subversive activity. We don't have any evidence of any of that in this toolkit. In fact, I'll share the toolkit with you. You can read it and let me know what is it that you find in the toolkit that you think instigates violence. For the life of me, I can find no such thing. But yes, there are links given there to the sites where if you go, you will find subversive advice, activity, and motivation. Now, these toolkits often also have tactical advice in terms of how do you manage if police uses this method or security forces use this method. So, for example, during Hong Kong protests, the protesters and the leaders were worried that there were too many cameras that the Chinese had watching everywhere. They were also using artificial intelligence to identify people. So they said, use helmets and use masks so you will not be identified. The masks are also to protect you from tear gas. And because we are talking Hong Kong, I will also tell you how these things change with technology and with times. When more than 30 years ago, I was going to cover the Tiananmen Square massacre in Beijing, we went via Hong Kong. So when we went to Hong Kong, we found there were many protests going on in sympathy with the student agitators in Beijing who'd been treated very cruelly by the Chinese authorities, and they were very emotional protests about them in their defense or in sympathy with them in Hong Kong. So at those protests, one thing that really caught my attention was a placard that said, "Facts saves lives." Think about it, facts saves lives. So 1989, why were people saying facts saves lives? Because facts was a technology that had just come in. In fact, by that time, India did not have any faxes available. So when I saw facts save lives, I said, what is facts and how does it save lives? And then we realized that in China, because the Chinese government, a communist government, were monitoring all phone calls very carefully and tracking agitators and their plans through the phone calls, they had not yet found a way of tapping fax communication. So they were asking people in China to use fax for communicating what was happening there, and not telegram or telex, which was the current communication medium those days, or telephone. So just as faxes saved lives now, today other things do, and you can say I am communicating by telegram, I am communicating by signal, etc., etc. So these approaches change as times change, but these toolkits also have tactical advice like this. So what was fax save lives was now let's talk on telegram, let's talk on signal, or let's delete what we have talked about. Now, of the so-called five subversive links that this toolkit had, as I told you, one was Ask India Why, which was then described as digital home to exploring geopolitics and ideas about freedom through data, writing and technology, especially about agricultural issues. And it says that this is an organization based in Canada, US and UK. Now, we know all the other details. I know all of you know better than mine, particularly whatever Rihanna did, Greta Thunberg did, Mia Khalifa did. So let's not go there, because that is now a bit of an old story. Let us see what is it that the police is holding these young people responsible for. They say that they drafted the toolkit. Once again, if I see the toolkit, I don't see anything subversive or secessionist in the toolkit. Now, a toolkit is also a dynamic document. So there was a press conference by Anish Roy, who's DCP cyber cell of Delhi police, who said that, look, this is not a static document. This is a document that's changing all the time. So the different people can edit, they can add different things to it, and they can add links and hyperlinks. They can deduct, they can add. In fact, this toolkit was changed dramatically once it seems that activists realized that Greta Thunberg had made a mistake by tweeting it, because they, when she tweeted it, she also had the names of these activists. So that's how those WhatsApp calls or Telegram calls have come out, where Disha Ravi is apparently or allegedly saying that, look, they will use UAPA against us, don't do this, don't share this toolkit. And then an edited, a deeply edited, shorter toolkit is put out, which does not have these links and stuff. So he says that the cop says that this is a dynamic document. This is an action plan which got accidentally shared. That is the police case. Now, the Delhi police's case is that Jan 26 action was a copycat execution of the toolkit. Although the toolkit doesn't say invade the Red Fort, unfurl the Sikh religious flag, etc., etc., it doesn't say that, but the Delhi police insists. And Delhi police says that these people, quote, I'm quoting from the police statement, that these people plan to create disharmony among various social, religious and cultural groups and encourage ill will and disaffection against government of India. Now, FFF, we told you, that is the Fridays for Future. Now, Fridays for Future has another affiliated organization called MAPA, M-A-P-A. M-A-P-A stands for Most Affected People and Areas. That is what Greta Thunberg is more involved with. So, FFF, with which Disha Ravi was involved in India, they campaigned on many environmental issues in India, including the RA Metro Park, where, if you might recall, I was on exactly the opposite side of the debate. I thought that there was no forest involved in this area, and that Metro Park was needed, and net Bombay was going to gain more environmentally if the Metro Park was built there and the metro line came up in time, because that saves you a lot more carbon emission. That was my view. These people were against that. So they were on the other side, but activism is not a crime. You can disagree with activists, as I did in that case. I still disagree with them. I think this error of shifting the metro park will delay that metro line by a long time and also add to costs in a very big way. But still, activism is not a crime. You cannot say that. Anyway, so it was through that network that they got involved with Greta Thunberg, or they attracted Greta Thunberg to their cause, because she has a big voice now globally. So in this entire picture or in this entire jigsaw, there is one piece which is the most troublesome. And what is that most troublesome piece? That's a man called Mo Dhaliwal. Mo Dhaliwal, Mo is short for Manminder Singh Dhaliwal. Manminder Singh Dhaliwal runs an ad agency, a digital ad agency in Vancouver. Vancouver has a large population of Sikhs in Canada. Now, it was Mo Dhaliwal whose agency Skyrocket also worked with a party, with a socialist party in Canada called NDP, National Democratic Party, run by a man called, a charismatic leader called Jagmeet Singh Dhaliwal, usually known as Jagmeet Singh. And he is the one who also gave Jagmeet Singh Dhaliwal's party its catch line or its tagline, which is love and courage. Although I must say that my dear friend Shambhit Sen Gupta, who lives in Bangalore and is an old guru in marketing, etc., etc., has been using as his sign off line on his WhatsApp messages for years now, if not decades. Nevertheless, now this Mo Dhaliwal is a colorful character, because not only does he run this ad agency which works closely with Canada's new, small, but a very radical opposition party and a very talked about newsmaking opposition party and its leader, but also at one point he set up something called Vancouver International Bhangra Celebration Society. So he's a colorful character, but he has a dodgy past, and that past is available in some of his Facebook posts and his statements. So in September 17, 2020, that was just a few months back when the farm agitation had already started in Punjab. He wrote, "I am a Khalistani. You might not know this about me. Why? Because Khalistan is an idea. Khalistan is a living, breathing movement." Now, I told you that I will not use this word again, but this is because I am quoting somebody. So he wrote this. Before that, on June 3, 2020, he put up a picture of Jarnail Singh Bhindranwale on his Facebook page and wrote under the picture, "Freedom from slavery is achieved only when a person starts to feel and understand that he would prefer death to life as a slave." Later, when he was asked by a lot of journalists from India, he said, "No, I never meant to support Khalistan. You read my entire Facebook post." Basically, he suggests that at the beginning I made a rhetorical point against injustice. Would that convince me? I am afraid not. Because if anything, not only is this person dodgy, but he's also got a lot of other people into trouble who might have been activists essentially because they were either pro-environment in their own way, although there is a certain contradiction in backing the kind of agricultural practices that Punjab has right now by environmentalists, because what's going on in Punjab right now for many years is depleting the water table, getting urea leaching into the soil. It's very environment friendly, but environmental activists can also be critical of Modi government, can also see this as a vehicle to resist the government. All that is legitimate and all that is legal. But the fact is, because Mo Dhaliwal's foundation got involved in this, they all get a little rub off, which is not a good rub off. That doesn't make them accomplices with Mo Dhaliwal. Now, I had also told you that there was another organization, another acronym, XR. That is not talked about that much, but when you research, you find it. XR stands for Extinction Rebellion. Why Extinction Rebellion? Rebellion, what does it do? Again, if you read their agenda, it says no religious, political and financial motive or agenda for researching. This platform is for researching, discussing, editing and circulating toolkits. You can read about this on Google as I did. So they might have made the toolkit, and that is why they are being charged. Now, if you look at Mo Dhaliwal, he's done plenty else at the same time. So Government of India has already made a mutual legal assistance request to Government of USA. And I think something like this will happen with Canada also, because SFJs, Sikhs for Justice, which was also co-founded by Mo Dhaliwal, has been banned. In 2019, Sikhs for Justice or SFJ, which mysteriously came up, gave a call for what was called as Referendum 2020, that in 2020 we'll register Sikhs all over the world and get them to vote on whether this state of Khalistan should be created or not. That completely failed. All over the world, not even 20,000 people registered for it. It was the biggest failure. In fact, now that Delhi police has registered a case against SFJ and NIA has registered a case against SFJ, people in Punjab, including my friends in Punjab police, tell me that this is a mistake because a dead organization is being given respectability. But Mo Dhaliwal is involved with that. There is no doubt about that. NIA in a pre-January 26 FIR had said that SFJ plans large-scale disruptive activities and damage to government and private properties and disrupt supplies and essential services to our capital city. The prime mover of SFJ was a man called Gurpatwant Singh Pannu, who is a designated terrorist now, and he's overseas, and I think efforts are being made to bring him back, and he's been active, making news occasionally. He filed a case against Kamal Nath in an American court, holding him responsible for the 1984 massacres of Sikhs in Delhi. That case was dismissed. Then he filed a case against Sonia Gandhi in an American court, saying that she was shielding some of those party men guilty of massacres in 1984. That case was also dismissed by the court. Then he filed a case also against Manmohan Singh when he was Prime Minister, saying that when Manmohan Singh was Finance Minister, that was under Narasimha Rao, he was responsible for funding some intelligence activity, etc., or covert activity that had led to extrajudicial killings of Sikhs. That case did not work. Then he tried to file a case against Rahul Gandhi when Rahul Gandhi said someplace that it could be that some Congress people were involved in 1984 pogroms and riots and killings in Delhi. So he's been active for a long time. In fact, he also said that he was going to set up the headquarters of whatever he was doing in Nankana Sahib in Pakistan or in Lahore. And at one point, he also got a little flicker of support or endorsement by a man called Sukhpal Singh Khaira, who was an Aam Aadmi Party MLA in Punjab. Sukhpal Singh Khaira, although was careful, he said that this idea of referendum 2020 had come up because of discrimination and injustice to the Sikhs, but he went on also to add that he did not support this idea, although it led to immediate protests by the Congress Party, BJP and the Akali Dal as well. And I think Aam Aadmi Party had also disciplined him at that point. Now, government is linking it, Delhi police is linking everything to the Sikh separatist movement. The reason they are doing it is that the most firm and the most committed agitators in this farm protest seem to be from Punjab. They are sitting at Singhu border, Tikri border around Delhi. And this has found quite an undercurrent in Punjab, especially among the Sikhs. It's also dividing the people of Punjab. So there are concerns in that area. And they think that global terrorist organizations, also Pakistan-funded, Pakistan-inspired, ISI-inspired organizations think that they can fish in these troubled waters. And frankly, if you ask me, why would they not? Because they've seen a little crack there, so they will run a dagger through that crack. That is how adversary countries act with each other. And that is what is happening. So it's quite likely that some of these organizations are involved in these activities. Also, it is quite likely, in my view, more likely than not, that these Indian activists have inadvertently got caught in this without understanding where some of these people are coming from. Until now, I have seen no evidence of anything that suggests to me that people like Disha Ravi or Nikita Jacob want India to be broken up or want a separate Sikh state to be carved out. But they are now being charged with guilt by association. Now, the story of Sikh separatism, I have to conclude this with a little story. The little story is that in the old days, that is 80s, when there was a lot of talk of a Sikh separate state, they also, a bunch of leaders sprouted up. So one of them was a man called Jagjit Singh Chauhan. Jagjit Singh Chauhan called himself the president of National Council of Khalistan, and he used to live in London. He used to call himself like the president of the government in exile. Then that cause was lost. Terrorism in Punjab was over by 1993. So in November of 1993, my colleague Nirupama Subramaniam, who used to then work with India Today, now works with the Indian Express in Mumbai, she and I went to Jagjit Singh Chauhan's house in central London. He was living in one of these welfare council houses on 12th floor, and we met him. And by this time, he was completely disgruntled and completely dissuaded from the idea of Khalistan through military movement. Now, I'm sharing that interview with you. Please read that interview in detail. I will just tell you a couple of highlights from this. He said, first of all, the Pakistanis promised us so much, but what did they give us? His words, they gave us Thanthan Gopal, which is nonsense. He was a good Punjabi. And he said, oh, Khalistan will come someday, but it will come in through when India breaks up like CIS, Soviet Union, or like European Union. India will have to reorganize itself. It can't come through arms. Then he also said that he had been invited by Chandrasekhar when he was Prime Minister to meet him at St. James Court Hotel in London. And he had told him also that, look, Sikhs don't take up arms. They don't kill anybody. And he said in this interview, it's a recorded, published interview, he said, if anybody opens fire, picks up a gun and fires a bullet, he's not a Sikh. Some bastard might do it. His words, not mine. Some bastard might do it. No real Sikh would do it. And then he said the Pakistanis on the one hand want to fish in troubled waters in Indian Punjab. On the other, they pull away. So he said that he has dealt with ISI officers, and one of them said, why don't you revive the agitation in Punjab again? And I said, I can't do it unless I have control of the Darbar Sahib. And he said, the ISI officer said, what is Darbar Sahib? So I said, you don't even know what is Darbar Sahib. And his words, Khalistan tuhanu bangan samaj aayega. Ye tuhanu Darbar Sahib samaj nahi aanda, Khalistan tuhanu bangan samaj aayega. Again, it's a published interview. You will find a lot of colorful language in that one. So please read that interview in full. He later came back to India. He was a frustrated, bitter man. He set up a party called Khalsa Raj Party, did a few funny things here and there, and then generally declined and passed away. Now, having told you all this, I will tell you one more sidelight from this story. That we've been researching. Now, Mo Dhaliwal, he says this Poetic Justice Foundation, he was helped to set it up by a woman called Anita Lal, who's her partner, friend, whatever, business partner in Vancouver. So Anita Lal's name also surfaces in this toolkit. So we researched who Anita Lal is, and we found Anita Lal does exist, but if you see her Twitter handle, I'm not sure, is it for real, is it something else? Because her Twitter handle is called Neeti420, Neeti420, and you know, for any Indian to use 420 or 420, what does that mean? That's a law for cheating. 420 mat karo, tum 420 ho, Raj Kapoor ki film Shri 420. So her Twitter handle is Neeti420, and I see her Twitter bio. It says, the minute I heard my first love story, I started looking for you, not knowing how blind that was. Lovers don't finally meet somewhere, they are in each other all along. So this sounds to me almost like a profound statement from Jaggi Vasudev. It doesn't sound like, sorry. So this sounds to me like some profound statement from Jaggi Vasudev, not like a statement from somebody who really wants you to know who he or she is.